Good evening. I'd like to open the...
How are you?
The meeting of the Deerfield Planning Board.
Everybody's got
Monday,
copies
January
of that.
4th, 2017... 2016. It's a correction on our agenda.
Thousands.
First correction. It's 7 o'clock here in the town offices of Deerfield. Happy New Year to everybody. We have on the agenda, we have public hearing. Actually, a review of the minutes from last meeting. Then we have two public hearings, both about the fee schedule. And I'll read that in a minute. Then we have public comment, old business, new business, and some mail. I don't believe we have any A&Rs or anything. Nothing came in, Doug?
No.
All right. So, mostly the public hearings. So, do we have the minutes from...
You should have them right on your desktop, right on your desk.
I just passed them out. They say December 7th, planning board on the top.
Excellent.
Which I hope is the right date.
So these are the minutes. All right, so we'll take a minute to look at that. Hey, Roger, we're doing the minutes from December 7th.
It is cold out. I think I saw 14 in my...
I got 12 on my truck coming here.
Did you? Yeah.
Comments about the minutes from...
That's the minutes.
We're missing who moved. I believe we're missing...
We usually haven't put them in before, but we can put them in now from now on.
Yeah, you have them? Or?
No, but we can...
Does anybody remember?
I don't think anybody remembers, but I'm sure it was probably Kip moved it and Rachel seconded it.
So I think we just say it was moved and seconded, and the minutes were accepted. So we can take out those blanks.
December 7th.
Yeah. That's yours.
Oh, okay.
And same on the closing. You usually just adjourn it.
Okay.
So
moved and seconded to accept the minutes as amended and do the same thing at the adjournment?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I would just say that the board business, the order of conditions, those were the order of conditions, the CONCOM, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think they came from the CONCOM.
The order of conditions came from the CONCOM. It was presented to this board, but I think you also signed your final determination, correct?
Well, that's what I was looking for, because...
Uh,
Yeah, we signed that number A is where we signed it here.
And we reviewed the Conservation Commission's order of conditions.
So the order of conditions was received from the Conservation Commission and reviewed?
Right.
And then...
We don't sign those orders of conditions.
No, right.
We signed our own.
Okay, but at that meeting, you did sign the final copy of the site plan approval letter.
There was a form that we signed.
The
site
final
plan review
site
approval
plan
with
review
because it had a
decision.
Because it had conditions on it.
We finalized it the month before, but nobody'd signed it yet.
We hadn't signed it, so we signed it.
If I could just add, Mr. Chairman, in regard to the minutes on something like vote to approve minutes or most votes, you do want to record who made the motion.
Okay, we can do that
for open meeting law. I think less so on the adjournment issue. Oftentimes, it'll just note a time when it's adjourned.
Yeah.
And you won't even have formal motions and everything. But all the other ones, if you have that information available, that is the kind of information the state would like to have.
Well, if nobody objects, we could put Kip and Rachel in there because I think that's probably what it was. I said it kind of in a joke, but I think it was. So we'll say that it was moved by Kip and seconded by Rachel.
So then we'll put the...
And one, two, three.
You want to
do... order of conditions were reviewed, and we signed the A&R approval.
The final site plan review decision... The site plan review decision for 901 River Road, as approved in November, was signed.
Right.
Is it okay?
Excellent.
Yep.
And then C, fee schedule, the board reviewed the draft submitted with our changes, which Pat Smith and she will create, which...
Maybe that matters with Pat Smith?
Yeah. The board reviewed the draft...
She will create a final draft document to use at a public meeting at our next regular meeting.
Right. We reviewed our changes with Pat Smith.
Okay. And I'll change that to final draft document to use at the public hearing at our next regular meeting.
Right.
Just so we have our verbiage.
Nice.
And, Paul, just for the record, I'm making these changes right now. And I can email everybody a copy of the final amended as soon as we're done.
And I would just ask that at the very top, planning board minutes. Put the word minutes in big letters because we have all this different paper and I don't know which is.
Yep, fair enough.
Excellent. All right, so with those changes, does anybody want to move to accept the minutes?
I make a motion that we accept the minutes as amended.
Okay. And now Rachel isn't here to second it. What are we going
to do? Remember what time you adjourned?
Max seconded it. What's that?
Do you remember what time you adjourned? Not that it really matters.
Oh, it was on there. I had the time on there.
You did?
No. It was like, I think it was close to 9 o'clock.
It was around 9 o'clock.
Yeah, I was 8:55.
It was a late meeting. I do remember that.
Yep. Fair enough. Okay.
Let me see if I can find it in here. It's in here still, right?
Possibly, yes. Take a look.
Let's see.
So Kip moved that. Max seconded it. All those in favor of accepting the minutes as amended, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
5-0-1. Roger wasn't here. So
yeah, I abstained.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, he looked puzzled. I just...
Oh, no, he knew, I think.
Yeah, I was just counting. Sorry.
Okay.
Getting up to 6 was hard for me.
Yeah. Well, I see you're writing with your left hand, so you'd have to take a shoe off or something for the 6.
Be careful over there. All right, so let's go into our... So I'd like to open the public hearing about the fee schedule. Pursuant to MGL, Chapter 4181Q, the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on Monday, January 4th, 2016 at 7:05 at the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass., to receive comment on proposed changes to the Deerfield Planning Board regulations governing fees and fee schedules. And simultaneously, we have a second public hearing, and that is about Chapter 264, Section 2260, entitled Fees Pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 40A, Section 5. The Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on Monday, January 4th, 2016, at 7:05 p.m. in the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass., to receive comment on the proposed changes to amend Chapter 264, Section 2260, Fees of the Deerfield Bylaws. So these two sections go together. We'd like to invite Pat Smith up to this fancy table that we have now.
This is a lovely arrangement. I feel so official tonight.
Kind of far away from you.
I'll just hand it over a sign-in sheet to Doug. We can all show that we were here. I guess I'm the public.
Welcome.
J&Q public today. I just want to, before we jump into this form, I just wanted to clarify on what was just read, what we're reviewing. So Chapter 264, Section 2260, Fees, is the piece of the subdivision regs, which refers to the fees there and had different fees that were in your planning board regulations. So it is under MGL Chapter 41, Section 81Q, that you would be addressing those subdivision regulations. The other piece that you are doing today is amending your planning board regulations governing fees and fee schedules, which is originally adopted May 5, 2008. Those internally require that you hold a public hearing. So it is under the authority of those that you are then holding the public hearing to update those. So just so we have that clear for the record, because that's been confusing us all along. Having said that, we did review these regulations, these fees, last month, and I made the changes and sent them out, and the chair caught at least one place where I had not reflected the will of the board, and so we fixed that. So I think that this now, you can see where the changes are shown highlighted in yellow and underlined or struck through. So you can see that the main schedule is on page 2, section 3.3. And so this schedule here will now replace, will be the one place where the dollar figures will show. So the subdivision rules and regs are being proposed that they will refer back to this place so that in the future, when you make any changes, you will make them only in this one place. So that will simplify matters administratively.
Pat, does this 3.3 schedule administrative fees exactly, I mean, other than what we're changing in the same location in the book?
This is what this document is, are internal rules and regulations of the board. Mm-hmm. So in terms of where they show up in the bylaws, the whole book compiled for the town. Mm-hmm. They are there in that they are compiled with your different application packets. So your special permit and site plan review packets that have been developed over the last 3 or 4 years, they contain the fees. So when you open up those packets, and when you look at them in the bylaws, as I look at them as they're online, I don't have the actual book, that's where they are contained. But they would have to be replaced in those, and in fact, I have a note to myself here to remind you that once you have adopted these new fees, then we will have to adapt those packets so that you can insert the new fees.
That's where I was getting at. This would end up in three different locations, if I'm not mistaken?
I don't know where the separate internal rules and regulations of the planning board are. I don't have a full compilation of the town bylaws. This is just the fees.
Correct.
So there may be other rules and regulations as well. I'm just not sure how, other than I know that it is in those packets because I have gotten into those packets. I don't know where else in the town bylaws these may be.
I see. Okay. I don't either. I'm not sure if they appear elsewhere other than in Chapter 264, Section 2260?
No, that's the subdivision of land, so they don't appear there. The wrong ones appeared there, not this.
Right, correct. And that's the hope is that we want to strike the references to the numbers completely from that and just point to this, which means it gives the planning board greater freedom to adjust this later on without having to go back to town meeting or anything like that. And it clears up the whole process by printing the numbers in one place.
So what we can do is go ahead and you know, once you guys get this to where you want it, you can approve these as they are. Then at your next meeting, we can bring in revised packets, special permit and site plan review packets that incorporate what you have approved, and then you can approve those packets. And in the meantime, Doug and I can work to make sure that we've located any other spots in the town bylaw books where they may be included and make sure.
Yeah, that's my only concern is that there's something in the zoning bylaw elsewhere. Yeah, but we haven't done an exhaustive check yet.
I don't think there is, but we'll check to make
sure.
We'll
have to. Yeah.
So we had just to quickly review entry point three. So for site plan reviews, $250 basic fee plus $10 for 1,000 square feet of land, up to a maximum land disturbance fee of $3,000. So the ultimate maximum, including the basic fee, would be $3,250. Everywhere where that $10 per 1,000 square foot was referenced in other fees going forward, that has all now been changed. So you see under special permit review too, $10 now per 1,000 square feet rather than 100. Mm-hmm. And any modifications or extensions of either one of those require an additional fee. A&Rs is $100 basic fee. And this is where we were English language challenged. Now, John suggested perhaps if we tried it in Spanish, it might work better. I haven't had an opportunity to do Google Translate. But it's $100 basic fee plus $50 each for the proposed net number of new lots to be created. So if you have one lot and you're creating a new lot, then you have a total of two lots, but a net increase of one lot. So you would be charged for that.
Which I think is actually how we've been doing
that's
it.
That's how you've been doing it. So we were trying to best reflect that to reflect your
usually
a total
comes in with one lot, they want to make two out of it, it's 150. So that's right. So, all right, good.
So then a preliminary subdivision plan was a $300 basic fee plus $50 per proposed lot. So on a definitive subdivision plan, if you have already done a preliminary plan, then you just pay an additional $50 per proposed lot. If you have not yet done a preliminary plan, then you would be charged at $300 basic fee plus $100 per lot. So in the end, it comes out the same. And this is where John helped me to get that straight. So you would pay the basic fee of $300 plus $100 per proposed lot total, whether or not you file a preliminary subdivision plan.
So there's an incentive to do a preliminary, right? Or at least it's not.
It's six to one, half a dozen of the other in terms of the cost. But doing a preliminary does have the added benefit of determining decisions that the board might have about how to construct the subdivision, so that you learn that before you do the fully engineered plans some other way.
The final cost is the same.
The final cost for the fee is the same.
Right.
And then the remainder of those alternative procedures plan is just there. It's something that exists in the subdivision regs. If you want to take a look at that at some point in the future, we could do that. And then we had added section I, which doesn't have specific dollar figures to it, but completes the full list of administrative fees that an applicant might have to pay, so that this is this is a complete listing here akin to what is included on those packets for the applications. So this matches what is on there. So that they could look here and they could understand all of the total number of types of fees that they might have to pay. Then on page three, under project review fees, we had made changes in regard to the review fees and when they were originally, it was said they had to be paid at the time of submittal. But this has changed so that it's paid at the convenience of the applicant, but until the fee is paid, the application is incomplete and no work will commence. No. So that tried to just clarify some of the timing issues as to when the application was made and how the fee would be paid in that regard.
The whole section on project review fees, formerly 4.3, has been removed and has been replaced. And that laid out some very specific fees, which was quite unusual. And 4.3 simply says that the project review fees shall be determined based on an estimate provided by a peer review consultant following an initial review of the application and the scope of work to be provided as defined by the planning board. So that's part of the reason why the timing references had to be changed, because that fee couldn't be paid up front since they wouldn't know what it was until there had been a review done by a peer review consultant. We, on page 5, indicated that the Office of the Town Accountant should provide reports on special accounts for peer review consultants on individual projects as defined in that whole section. And then on page 7, we added a no issuance of permit decision for delinquent accounts.
I don't have a page 7.
Page 6.
Yeah, it's page 7 on mine.
Well, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 2.
We get 6 on the new one. Last month we had 7.
What are we looking at, Pat? What section?
Where are you at? 5.1, 2, and 3?
There's 3 sheets of paper, 2 sides.
I have 7 pages printed in my version, dated 1/4/16.
Yeah.
Public hearing draft 1/4/16.
Yeah.
You've got probably a couple single-sided ones.
No, I do not. I have double-sided. 7 ends about halfway down the page.
Well, on page 6, the last is 6.1 amendment, A, B, and C.
Well, that's the end of it. I'm not quite
but
sure your, how that managed.
Your second page looks like a lot of verbiage and highlight.
Did you cut out? Did you remove the stuff that had been?
Nothing. All I did is put it into final mode and.
Can I see your version?
You
I just want to make sure that we have, because there was that whole section 4.3 which was deleted, and it's possible that it's just got removed on your version.
It's just been removed.
It was removed. So that's the difference.
So what you're looking at does not include some of the text that was deleted.
So you'll see, if you can see across the room, this half of this page is all stuff that was deleted, and then on your version it was just taken.
Right.
So that's
it was on last
that's month.
The confusion. I didn't actually delete anything. It might have been.
It probably just, you know, it's how you review. I blame Bill Gates every day for something or another. Tell you what. So, so that final piece, 5.4, on whatever page you find
on
it.
On page 6. Middle of page 6.
There's no issuance of permit decision for delinquent accounts.
Mm-hmm.
And then there had just been a typo under 6.1. Affect needed to change to effect in section B. So those were the changes.
Nice. That matches my notes from last month. Thank you.
Just so I'm clear, everything that's highlighted in yellow is additions. All the deletions do not appear.
Right.
You are not seeing the deletion of 4.3.
Right.
Yep.
Okay. Right, we got the clean copy.
Yep.
Without the. All right, and then we go to section. Chapter 264, section 2260.
And Doug had worked, even as we were speaking last time, to do a very quick and elegant fix to the language to that to make it just referential, not specific.
Right, so we're taking away all the numbers, right?
Right.
Yes.
And making a general statement. The schedule of fees shall be determined and amended by the planning board, which schedule of fees shall be filed with the town clerk and made available to the public upon request at the Deerfield town offices during normal business hours.
The language seems a little bit clunky, but I think I pulled that from either another part of our bylaws, another unrelated section, or found similar language elsewhere that seemed to work. That which throws folks off.
It's got that legalese thing.
Yeah.
It's got the comma before it, so that's good.
But The bottom line is it's pointing to the schedule of fees, which you just reviewed, instead of trying to double encode it.
And which will, by its own internal rules, be filed with the town clerk and will be...
Exactly.
And you'll figure out where these two fit.
Well, so this, what you're talking about, section 2260, that is a revision to your chapter 264 subdivision of land, your rules and regulations regarding subdivision.
It's our second public hearing.
Correct.
Depending on how you want to...
The other half of your public hearing.
Yeah, there's two listed here.
Yeah, they're joint. But so this is that second piece. And so what will have to be done is a new version of the subdivision of land will have to be generated that has this new 2260.
Right.
What you want to do is vote that today as it currently is with this change. And then once you just get that document together, you file it with the registry of deeds and then make sure the town clerk has it.
That I know can be done at this meeting tonight, the changes to the schedule of fees.
Yes.
Because that's an internal thing.
Yes.
My understanding is that because this is part of the bylaw, that it has to go before town meeting.
I think you should talk to town council about that because the subdivision regulations on their own do not go to town meeting. It is not required.
Okay.
So
we'll have to check. Yeah.
I don't see why, in order to compile them into the book, that would require waiting to go to town meeting when it is not required under the statute that happen. So, but we can confer.
Might be a good
council.
Idea just to cover ourselves to make sure that we're not skipping any steps.
Because typically those the books of the bylaws are not voted as a whole, but are voted as a piece and are simply compiled by general code.
Okay.
But we can talk with general code and with town council just to be absolutely clear on that. But I think if they vote that revision to the subdivision of land.
That
they
it just
will
goes
have
into
done
effect
their piece.
As soon as it's filed with town clerk. Okay.
And the registry of deeds.
Sure. Why don't we get solid clarification on that for you for the next meeting? But once you close your public hearing and vote on the schedule, that goes into effect immediately,
I think. That's what I was going to say.
We can
still do all the votes.
So you can start charging new prices. Woo-hoo.
All right.
So.
So I'd like, at this point, the public hearing is still on. Anybody from the public have any comments or questions or would like to revise the schedule of fees, please come forward at this time. Hearing none. Does anybody on the planning board want to make any comments while the public hearing is still open? Then do we have a motion to close the public hearings?
I'll make a motion to close the public hearings.
I'll second it.
And just like to clarify that that's closing both public hearings since they're the same subject. All those in favor of closing the hearing? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? 600. So without taking any new information in, are there any questions or comments from the planning board members? Or are we ready to move to accept and approve these changes? I think we're ready.
I'm good.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the changes.
I'll second it.
If I could, Mr. Chairman, you might want to separate the vote.
Since we had two different schedules. So
I will make a motion to accept the changes for the regulations and governing fees and fee schedules, draft dated 1/4/16, to make it permanent.
And I'll second that motion.
Any comments? All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Abstain? And so regulations governing fees and fee schedule has been approved 600.
Okay. And what was your, can you give me your motion again, John?
Document dated 1/4/16, public hearing draft.
We're accepting
the changes.
Okay, the changes.
Regulation and governing fees and fee schedules.
Okay, the second one, we're just we're just...
We're about to make that motion now.
I'd like to make a motion.
Well, I thought that's what you were doing now, but you're on the first one?
That was the first one.
We already voted on the first one.
Well, I know that, because that's why I was just trying to...
Yeah.
Okay, let me go back and... So we voted to close the meeting, that's the first step. Then we had a second motion.
Voted to close the public hearings, both of them.
Close the public hearing. Okay, and then we had another vote after that, which is what we're talking about now. Okay, to accept the changes to the fee schedule, is that basically what you want to do?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Accepted to change the fee schedule as per the draft dated
1/4/16.
And then we're going to put we got to put a date in there, correct? So is that today's
just
date?
Just one comment.
Yeah.
Well, I think it would be helpful going forward if you actually wrote out regulations governing fees and fee schedules.
Yeah, I think
as John has said, because I think that'll help make it clear which is which.
Okay, I'm sorry, say that again.
You see the top of it? You have it in front of you?
Governing fees and fee schedules. Just write like the title at the top of the
page. All right.
Deerfield Planning Board's regulations.
I'll just put Deerfield Planning Board regulations and governing fees and fee schedules.
Yep.
Okay, change that.
And then this one, it's just 264, section 2260. Let us know when you're ready.
I can go back and put that in.
All right.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion for the recommended changes to chapter 264, subdivision of land, section 2260, fees section. And if I'm not mistaken, it's basically deletion on this page of the fees.
And insertion of a...
Oh, is that inserted?
Yeah, that okay. Insertion of a...
So any changes, there's no date on this.
You can say as presented.
As presented
as
tonight,
presented,
yeah. As presented on 1/4/16.
To accept the changes as presented...
Adopt the changes as presented for chapter 264, section 2260.
Adopt...
Do you have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Who moved it?
John
I moved
it.
That's right.
Kip, we're making it easy.
Yep.
Any opposed or abstentions? So that's 6-0-0, approved 6-0-0 as well. So these can take effect immediately, and then we'll get them into... So the first thing is to get them to the clerk's office, like, tomorrow.
The regulations go into effect right away, right?
Yeah, so we'll need to clean
right,
those
the clerk, effect. The clerk needs to know about it.
Yeah, they
the clerk
have to go to the
need
down
to have
clerk.
That filed? Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll need to clean that up. Do you need me to help with that, or do you...
No, so long as I...
You've already done half of it, by thanks to Bill Gates.
Yeah, there you go.
You're halfway there.
Yeah, assuming that all I need to do is get rid of your note at the top
the
of the first
that's
page.
A header. Yeah.
Change the revised insert date to reflect today.
Right.
And then remove all the highlighting.
Right.
Right?
Yeah. Just accept the changes.
Other than that, I think that's... And remove the draft.
Right. You want to change, you know, that header from public hearing draft to...
Yeah, absolutely.
Approved, you know, or whatever. You know, you
yep.
might even put the approved date up there or whatever.
Yep.
But just so it doesn't say public hearing draft anymore.
Sounds like a plan.
I'll be in and out of the office for meetings, but if you have a problem, let me know and we can work it out.
That's what I'll do is I'll make the changes. I'll get them to Pat for her final review to make sure I haven't missed anything, and then we'll get them over to town clerk and have her stamp and copy a copy of it so she confirms that she received it.
Yeah, excellent.
And then we need to get it also to the registry. This,
no, this does not
this
go
doesn't
to
go to the
registry.
Just goes to town
clerk.
Okay,
yeah.
Very good.
And we'll make copies of the clean version. to get to you next month for your books.
Yep.
Excellent.
Good work. That's been a project long talked about.
Talked about.
It's like climactic, we're all being real quiet, but it's a good move to have taken care of that and cleaned that up.
Yes, and that'll hopefully last for a long time now.
So I'm going to go back here. There may be some other things you need to call me up for, but I will remain in the public seat until that time.
Thank you very much, as usual, for your assistance. No. Yes, actually, one of the new businesses is we might have a question for you.
Okay. I have some other materials for you, too.
Item 5, public comment. Again.
Actually, I'll take this opportunity because I'm really hoping to leave sooner rather than later. I've been here since about 12 hours now. Okay. You have in front of you a bill that we received from Pat Smith.
That was going to be my new business.
If you would just initial or indicate okay to pay. Some of that bill, I believe, is related to the 901 River Road project. So I'm wondering, did you request peer review monies for that project, or
no? Because we it was CONCOM that was having the outside engineer peer review.
Okay.
We did not have.
We did not.
No, okay. We said we were going to go with theirs.
Right.
Yeah. So that should all be billed to the CONCOM, actually, and then they should charge the applicant.
Oh. Okay.
Right.
So I guess the only thing I would love to have you do, maybe you can just do this on your own, is look at the charges on the invoices, and just make a determination if any of them need to be paid outside from a place other than the planning board account, if that makes sense. You don't have to do it now. You know, you can get to that eventually or whatever.
Yeah.
So.
Because would some of them come out of that revolving account or not?
I think so.
So we'd have two accounts to.
There's the regular appropriation, and then there is the revolving fund. And actually, the revolving fund is where the site plan review filing fees would go. So if we can take those things related to 901 River Road and pull it from that revolving fund, that would be great.
All right.
Does that make sense?
Yes, maybe Pat and I should go over that then even. I mean, some of it would be.
You have?
Well, I
don't know if they gave you the whole bill. I do have extra copies if you don't have that full bill there. Because it does, the second page with the invoice.
Yep,
yeah.
It's got that.
It's broken out by task, the very final sheet.
Yep.
And there you can see that 82.5 of the 132.5 hours that were billed for this 6-month period were on that solar project.
Yeah. So that's
The bulk of it.
Okay. So there we go.
And I can do the, you know, the quick dollar figure run for you so you can know how many dollars that equates to.
And I know you have a lot more in your revolving account than you have in your budget line item, so.
But is this technical assistance coming out of a DTL? Is this a grant or?
This is all coming out of our contract with you, which is to provide technical assistance with it. It's a contract with the town to provide technical assistance to the planning board. I should be up here, I think, probably, so people can hear me.
Yeah, sorry.
So this.
But where's the money coming from? This isn't.
I don't know. That has always been what you guys have decided.
Oh, okay. So
we have a contract with you for up to $10,000 to provide technical assistance.
Right. But it's not from that state DTA.
No, that is not from DLTA funding, because that's completely separate, where you don't pay anything for those services.
Right.
That comes from
right.
DHCD.
Okay, so this does come from.
So it may be that in the past that some of the fees paid for COG technical assistance have come from the revolving fund versus your general account.
Well, I'm not privy to that information.
I got it totally.
That comes to the next item. The annual budget, because I asked for, and I wanted everybody to get a copy of it, and I don't think we have it.
I can get a copy for everybody right quick, and I will do that right away.
What monies we spend and which pot they came out of, because that revolving fund, mostly money goes into it, and we don't, at least to our knowledge, we don't say take it out of that, usually. And I was curious whether, when it gets back to the town staff, whether they kind of do that or not. And so they did give me some summary reports, but I kind of wanted to... you know, an itemized.
Am I understanding correctly that the bill that John was looking at, there was about 100 hours that were billed, and about 80 of the 100 you say were for the solar?
It's 132.5 hours and 82.5. Yeah, I have copies of this bill for all you guys, so why not?
So 82 hours were for that solar.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's a big chunk of time.
Yeah,
that money should be covered by fees and schedules.
That's kind of what I was trying to figure out real quick here.
Thanks.
Well, you mean it should be billed back to the applicant?
The monies that we take in for fees and schedules, may not all be a perfect fit each time.
Right.
But over the course of time in that revolving fund, that's what should pay for Pat's services is the fees and schedules.
And I guess they're saying, did we? How close did we come? Did we?
Well, that's what I want.
Yeah, I think.
Well, we're going to come pretty close because, for example, we these folks paid $3,250.
Right.
$3,250
right.
to the planning board's revolving fund, and a lot of that's going back out.
And so how many hours are out of that?
Pat,
are
make
covered
it easy for
that?
Me. What's how much an hour do they charge for that?
Well, I don't have the exact figure in front of me, but I can give you a ballpark figure.
And I have.
So then, and I can get you the exact dollar figure.
No,
tomorrow.
I don't need exact. I just.
It's about. Well, no.
In the past, I was always in the assumption it was around $50.
Yeah, well, overhead's 100, so it's more like 60.
Okay.
So that's just under $5,000, and I'll get you the exact to-the-penny figure in the morning.
So you're saying it's just under $5,000 was spent on that project? Sure, you guys, and we collected $3,250. Is that right?
That's about
over $2,000 in the black. I mean the red.
The red.
In the red.
Yeah.
So. There.
So we take it out of the.
So in theory, the taxpayers took a $2,000 hit, not on this one because we were under the old fee schedule, correct?
No.
No, these guys paid $3,250.
According to what you've just done.
That's exactly how we started to figure this out.
It wasn't, you didn't figure that out on the basis of trying to cover this particular cost. And as John said, sometimes, you know, costs for under the general fees are higher than what you charge, and sometimes they're lower than what you charge. And the presumption is if you target them just right, that you know, it's a wash at the end of the year between all of the different projects.
I think if we can track them going forward and see how we did after a period of time, we may have to adjust our numbers if they don't match, you know.
Would it be a fair assumption to say that the majority of your time on that solar project was going over their reports and coming up with, you know, what they complied with and what they didn't comply with?
Yeah, and preparing, going over the multiple versions of the plans,
right.
and then preparing multiple versions of that report that, as you remember, got longer and longer and longer. And then we provided the decision, the draft decision for you, and the final decision.
That leads me to another whole thing is, if you guys think about it this way, you know, being a part-time board, that we're all volunteers, there's language in our bylaws to charge for peer review.
Right.
And in a sense, you know, none of us take the time to read these reports in any detail and compare it to our site plan. We hire outside assistance. In this case, it's Pat from Hakon. So isn't that, in a sense, peer review?
I think that's a good point, is what do we consider that? And then in the fee schedule we just set, we said that we try to get an estimate of what that's going to be and bill it to the people. And so that's a hard thing, but I think that is something that we should think about more going forward, certainly.
Yeah. I mean, my big thing was how much dollar we were collecting from these people.
Yeah.
And you know, what it was getting used for. But, you know, the assistance that we're getting from Pat is no different than if we hired an engineer, whether it be a civil or environmental. It's still, you know, somebody's expertise outside of our field to do that.
Right.
And, you know, I kind of think that's peer review.
In the end, I mean, as long as it's a zero net gain, by the taxpayers, however it needs to be done. I agree with you. I can't see why that couldn't be.
You mean gain or loss?
Well, Yeah, right, it should be, you know, see, one thing that I've heard people say in the past is that it's just another tax, it's, you know, trying to extort money, but that's not the case, not the way I see it, at least. It's, mm-hmm. it's just so that the taxpayers don't bear the burden of a project. And
then this,
would we have to argue that out with the applicants, do you think, that it's considered peer review and therefore...
No, I think any...
You're found responsible
any
for
any thick report like this, they know we're going to have to review it and we're going to have to hire someone.
Right.
So
it was a cost we incurred in reviewing the project.
That's a good point by Kip.
Send them a bill.
Yeah.
Just tell them the fee didn't cover all the costs associated with the job.
I think it's important not to try to kind of get this water muddied, if you will. You know, our fee was our fee for what we did, but, you know, we needed outside assistance to do this peer review. Just like, you know, we didn't have the expertise to do what Pat did. We don't have the expertise to do the stormwater stuff. They had to hire, you know, their engineer, and then the town hired another engineer, the peer review. I kind of think this is the same scenario.
So is anybody suggesting we go back to this applicant, or are we more talking going forward?
I don't really see any. I don't have an issue with if you say going back, because it's not. I mean, yes, they do have their permits and stuff like that, but I don't know. I think we should talk about it a little bit.
I mean, our bylaws say that the planning board shall impose reasonable fees for the review of applications which come before it.
Right.
The planning board may impose administrative fees and project review fees, as may be applicable to the types of applications set forth below.
And I think this definitely was a project review fee.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're getting the bill now, so we couldn't have known it up front.
Exactly.
Well, if you're going to discuss that, let me know so I can go to that side.
Oh, that's right.
Going to the dark side. Huh?
So if I may, Mr. Chairman, I mean, this is why we started tracking by task a couple of years ago, so that these discussions and these decisions could be made. We now have a couple of years and a couple of projects where we see what has been required for their review. So I think that going forward, that would give us a good basis if you wanted to bill our time out in that way, so that you could take that, we could be used as an estimate, and that could be given to the applicant at the outset.
And
I'm somewhat reluctant to go after the fact when they had not been given the indication that that was going to be part of the bill. But that's up to you guys.
I feel very strongly that, you know, I pushed that I thought the initial fees was too high. And that at several meetings, the applicant sat in the audience, and I was very careful about it was separate from peer review. Peer review, we always have that ability to charge for peer review. I mean, it's nothing like, you know, it's not like we're going back necessarily because we didn't know what it was.
The engineer and the peer review engineer gives an estimate based on, and so they do have... It had, and no work starts until the money's been deposited. So we're pretty far down the road from that process being able to be followed in an open, transparent way.
I mean, do say that there'd be an estimate and that money would be deposited into a special account.
But I would be happy going forward on the basis of what we've done to date and providing you an estimate, you know, of like a medium size or a large project. And if it, you know, as it works with all 4453G projects, if it's overestimated, they get the money back. If it's underestimated, they have to pony up some more cash before it can be complete.
Well, you know, may I make the suggestion that, John, you don't feel comfortable doing it, we could do it as a board. We could prepare a bill and send it to them. Well, I was saying, you know, they came in as we were restructuring our fee thing. Mm. The initial fee was going to be around $80,000+.
Yeah.
We ended up charging them $3,250.
Yeah.
This is our portion of the expense of our peer review, which is roughly $4,500, you know, and here it is.
Pay the difference?
So the bill you're sending them, you're saying, would be $3,250 from $5,000 or whatever the number is.
Yeah.
And so about $1,750.
Would then be called peer review?
Yeah.
No, send them a separate bill.
Right, but the figure, the number...
Would be 45, roughly $4,500.
Full cost of the services provided by Pat Smith as part of her involvement with that project?
I think so, because
The whole $5,000, you're saying?
Right, that was the cost of the peer review.
What's the incentive for them to pay it? Or what's their ability, what's our ability to legally charge that after the fact?
I don't think we have any, but I think if they pay it...
So let me just clarify, because now, you're saying send the $5,000 bill or the $5,000 minus the $3,250?
No, the $5,000 bill.
So then where does the $3,250 go?
That was our fee, and that goes into our revolving fund.
Right, to pay a few hours to someone...
It doesn't pay staff, it doesn't pay salaries out of that.
Actually, if we needed you and we couldn't bill them, we would have money to pay.
So that just goes in the revolving fund, none of it gets...
Yeah. Oh, thanks, John. So I guess at this point, I would be more very inclined to say they paid the difference, because I do would agree with you that they saw some of our discussion, and I think they saw that we were cutting them, they were getting a good deal at the end of the
exactly.
day.
But
I'd have a harder time billing the whole $5,000. But if I said $5,000 minus the $3,250, pay the difference, and I think they would be actually pretty amenable to that. Without,
well, I think Kip is right. I think we should bill them the whole $5,000.
You know, I think, John, what I'm looking at is, I think if you I understand exactly what you're saying, but to me that's kind of like you're blurring the two things together. And you know, we have a fee schedule that we amended for them, which is totally independent from the peer review process, and that if we charge them that amount of money for the peer review, I mean, it's not, you know, it's
we didn't duplicate the technical peer review.
Right.
No.
The CONCOM did their review, and we accepted that. And
right. Well,
we
actually,
had another
Pat
review.
Pat actually had to even kind of see, make sure that was going well too. That was part of our due diligence, was to have that review.
Exactly.
Too. Yeah. We call it a project review fee. It's
John.
It's not a peer review, I think, is when you get the engineer. Here we call it a project review. That's kind of what I would consider that Pat's been doing. So
peer review is variously defined. You know, sometimes people include legal fees in it, and other times they don't.
Right.
And it's unclear as to the statutory framework,
but I'm saying
whether that's allowed or not. So it's kind of
4.3 is very clear. Project review. Let's just use that term.
Yep.
So then I get back to, then you get back to Doug's question, is what, you know, what do we
can
do
you charge
if they don't
them
pay?
After the fact?
Yeah, but a lot of times you're not going to know what the peer review is. I've sat where we've had engineers, and they'll say, we'll ask them a ballpark figure, how many hours, whatever, and they'll give us a ballpark figure. But there's nothing set in stone ever until they really get into it.
Except that the applicant does know that they're
paying for that,
and there's
case,
a process by which a figure will be...
If we asked, in case you didn't even hint at the beginning of the process that you would be charging a peer review.
In hindsight, Pat, if you had to give that quote to us today, what would it have been?
Based on the information I have today, I'd say for a project of that nature coming over again, I'd say about $5,000.
Okay, so the total
different
number,
project comes in, I'd look back for Walter's propane and see how much we spent on that one, because that was a little bit less complicated, but nonetheless, we spent some time on it.
I'll have a range of a couple
of different projects that we could look at going forward and figure, okay, well, this is maybe where we think this is going to be, and it would give a reasonable approximation
I want to reiterate that I did say multiple times it was totally, the fee schedule is totally different,
separate from
the peer review process. You know.
All right, so I go back to my question. So it sounds like we have some consensus. We'd like to charge them the $5,000. My now question is, how do we enforce that?
We don't.
I don't think we can.
If they pay it, then that's fine. If they don't, there's not much you can do at this point.
You've already
signed the paper.
Right.
It's just a good faith thing. If they choose not to, we have no recourse. And I think we chalk it up to experience if it doesn't get paid. But we might at least try.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. I think so.
Because it says the one thing that we can do is no final permit or decision of the planning board shall be issued until all delinquent accounts are paid in full. So we've made our, they haven't got a certificate of whatever from the building inspector yet. It's not finished.
No, but they do have your decision. And the building inspector won't hold up any building permit or completion of work.
Yeah.
based on a bill from the
planning board. I think if you think about it and you say, you know, you could even word it that, you know we're sorry that it got too late, but we just got our bill and this is what it is. And
All right. So
was there, if I may ask, was there any communication with either New England Environmental or Lake Street Development where the planning board said we may charge peer review fees? Is there something you can point to in the minutes?
There was always, as Kip said, we were always clear that any kind of specific peer review about this project would be built separately. Yes, there was always that discussion.
Okay. If you're confident in then we can generate a letter and an invoice and we'll see what happens.
And I'd like it to be the same amount that you charge us for that.
I will.
Rather than just saying $5,000.
If you can clarify a figure for that, yeah, please. Thank you. Put it together and John, I'll have that ready in a day or so and have you sign it.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Great.
Okay.
Cool. All right, thanks. See, this is why getting all this information in front of us is good.
So do we vote on this or do we just say it was decided to do?
Yeah, this was an administrative thing, so that's
okay. So we don't have to vote. Okay.
If I may speak to a couple more things that are on your agenda, and I don't mean to rush your agenda. You've got a copy of the budget.
Yep.
That's those numbers, I believe, are draft, but I think I had some consultation with you, John, on the requested for FY17. If the board doesn't feel as though that's enough or doesn't feel those numbers are correct, just modify as you need to. Let me know. We'll put it into the request. And there is, I just wanted to remind you, there is also a request for comment in the mail from, I think, ZBA on a matter that's coming up.
All right.
But other than that, I'm going to take my leave, step away from the table.
Could I just ask you one thing? I wanted to say, we're sort of still on public comment portion here, is that I learned that our administrative person, Casey Warren, is going to be leaving.
She submitted her resignation in December 30th. Her last day is this
Wednesday,
Friday,
the 8th.
Friday, the 8th.
So, as chair of the planning board for many years, having worked with Casey for many of those years, I just want to express my thank you to her and get it in the minutes that we say goodbye and best wishes and good luck in her next. But she's been a pleasure to work with, and I think the town's gonna miss her.
Very much so.
So, just wanted to make that part of our minutes.
Thank you.
And we look forward to maybe next month we'll hear more of what's next with the town staffing.
It'll be exciting. It'll be exciting. Thank you. I'll pass on your good words as well.
Thanks. We'll get her an email this week, too. So she's here till Friday. Okay.
She's here till Friday. I realize I'm doing this on television, but, you know, why not? Who cares? I would also like to invite every one of you to join us tomorrow evening at the club. I've been told to call it the club. People know what that means. From 4 o'clock on, we're going to just be raising a glass of mineral spirits or otherwise, and toasting her best wishes. Please join us if you can make it.
Great.
If you care to.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Glad people are doing something.
You too, Pat.
Thanks, Doug.
Thank you.
All right, so no old business. Well, we've taken care of a bunch of old business.
Yeah, I'd like to mention that over the last couple of weeks, I've spent a couple of hours in the building inspector's office. We had spoken about building lot sizes and stuff like that. You wanted to know what changed. And it kind of brings in a couple of things. I read the planning board's minutes from 1995 to present, and there was no mention of it at all.
Mention of what?
There's no mention of changing building lot sizes. So I don't know if it happened prior to that. I'm going to go back and read further. And I've tried to, even though I've been there three different times, I haven't connected with Dick to see if he has any recollection of it.
It would have been in the 83, 84 range, 85.
You think that's when it was?
86.
Well, I did a lot of reading. But that did leave me with one thing. After reading the minutes that, from the planning board years past, and you know the little discussion that we just had about billing these people, I found a new importance that minutes should be a little more detailed, and I don't know how we can go about it, but I think we should spend some time to do that, because I've read these minutes where somebody said this, then somebody said that, and there's no conclusions, and then you go on for months and months, and there's no rhyme, no reason where these things dropped, where they... It's really, and then you go back to when it was handwritten, it was even worse. But, you know, it, I can see where...
Do you see any in the past year or two, any better?
Oh, it got much better from, like, about 2010.
Okay.
You know, but that, but the early one...
We get on the board.
Oh, we've been on longer
than Yeah. Well, about give or take a few years, yeah.
We also had brief discussion, and since I've done a little checking into, would anybody have appetite for hiring a stenographer?
That's what I was thinking while you were talking.
$50 to $75 a meeting, but you know, then you don't get a general thing. You know, you can get what everybody said as long as we speak one at a time.
I know, Kip, that when I went to the took our course back when we first got on the board. Yeah. They said that you can pick whatever you want, but you could actually save a digital recording of the meeting if you want to and use that as your minutes, as you think. But if you don't save the thing, then whatever's written is what you go by. So,
but the written word would be easier to, you know.
Right, I think.
For like what you were trying to accomplish, yeah. The written word is much easier than a disc that you have to watch the whole disc.
I wondered that program they call Dragons, like $75, does that really work that well to transcribe it?
Over the years, I've bought a couple of those. I don't know if
I don't know. I'm just asking the question because I've seen them on TV. I just didn't know if that did it.
But I think the other point is we don't want to record every single word we say. We want to have minutes that are readable by the public also, right?
And then have the content. They're always draft, and then when they come to the next meeting, we review them and decide.
Yeah. We don't want to review a 10-page written minute.
Exactly. So, I mean, we can be, diligent about reviewing the draft and correcting anything that we think is wrong.
Okay.
I mean, does that make sense, Kip, or do you want to actually get
From reading Pat, you know, going back and reading them, I had no clue of what was going on. You know, I my name showed up in five or six different areas, and even though I was there at some point, I still had no idea what I was there for, and I thought that was very odd, you know.
Well, now, I know that we've got a tape recorder, and I know that you can save the files. You could even save the WAV files. I mean, do you want to have that as a backup to what we talk about here?
I thought the video recording.
We have a video as well.
Yeah, we got the video. Yeah, but we have to make a decision to save it or not save it, I guess, is the... The thing.
Well, I think that what we're trying to get at is what's going to be written down. Yeah. The written minutes should be so a reader knows what we were talking about and what the decisions were.
Right.
That's what you're asking.
Yes, sir.
And those are actually the legal.
Right. Yeah, and that's what gets counts as the legal.
We decide what's legal. If we decide that the written word is the legal thing, that is it. We've decided that. Yeah.
It goes on the website so the public can read it.
I'm hearing two different things here. I'm hearing that... that we have the recordings of it as well, but once we make our decision, we don't keep
that's
both.
That's all Kip's talking about is the written minutes.
I think John was talking about the...
I made a comment about a stenographer, and it's true, we don't need every single word, but you still should be able to go back and read it enough to know what we were talking about.
Well, ideally we would have an administrative assistant that kind of knew what needed to be, and that's where a stenographer would be everything. And, an administrative assistant that knew what we were talking about would be in a perfect world. But
so let's bring that back to staff. We did talk about it, I thought, recently, and then we even wondered if Doug would play that role, but the town can't supply a staff person to all of our meetings.
Or maybe take some input from us, whoever's taking the minutes, make sure you get that. I don't know.
Yeah, that might be a good thing to do. Say, this is a good thing. Let's make sure it's in the minutes. Mm.
Okay. The other point, and this and a lot of other committees I'm on, the minutes come out in advance and we review them in advance and you give comments.
Right.
And so by the time you get here, you're really getting to the, you're ready to finalize.
You'll pick up hopefully the loose ends.
That has never occurred on this board.
Well, I guess that's...
Did Doug make this, the planning board?
Well, now I'm curious.
Did Doug make this, or did you?
I did.
You did.
He organized it and put the blueprint headings on it. He did that, but these are the minutes that I took.
Could you email this, or whomever, email it to us, even if it was...
Well, that's a bit tricky, and I don't see that we couldn't do that. But when I leave here tonight, whatever's on here, I don't have access to it. In other words, it's here, and if they could make it available, or if I brought a memory stick...
You can't email it right off of that?
I can't. I haven't found out how to do that.
Oh, so that's maybe one of the things.
If I could email it off, that would be great.
You could just send it to all of us, and tomorrow morning we'd all look at it. Yeah.
That would be perfect, yeah.
Still fresh in our minds.
If you had let's work on that. OneNote or something like that, you should be able to do that with, OneNote.
If I brought a memory stick and plugged it into USB, I could copy this and take it home with me, but I didn't. That's not been, this is here, and when I talked with Doug, he went and picked these minutes up, which I save in the computer here, and then the computer stays here.
All right. Let's talk to Doug about that.
So, Mr. Chairman, while you guys were starting to talk about that, Kip was making reference to the minimum lot size.
I noticed that. So you, of course...
You guys had a discussion about that last time we met and had asked for the dimensional schedules for a couple of surrounding towns. So that's what I handed you from the towns of Whately, Sunderland, and Hatfield. So those are three tables of dimensional requirements for you to take a look at and see how they compare to those here in Deerfield. And as you'll see, just looking at the Whately on top, one of the things you had discussed was distinguishing between lots that have public water and or sewer, and you can see that's done in Whately. It's a little bit more complicated and hard to read in Sunderland. And then Hatfield is quite complicated, but once again, it makes distinctions on lot size as to what town services are available. Mm-hmm. So those give you some examples of things nearby to look at as you're thinking about that, which came up in regard to the stormwater.
Right.
Okay. So we talked about changing the dimensional. So the question is, if they're out of sync, which one do you want to change? Right. Do you want to change the dimensional schedule so that what is required doesn't trigger stormwater permit, or do you want to change the trigger for the stormwater permit to something larger that doesn't? That's two different ways you could go about it. But anyway, you have a little bit more information for that ongoing discussion.
Thank you. So I noticed that wasn't on tonight's agenda. So maybe we take this and we can look at this over the next month, and then we put it on next month's agenda.
Sounds good.
And I think one thing is we want to see what the board thinks about it, and then whether we need to schedule public hearings and stuff like that. So, but this is great having this information. Thanks, Pat.
And if you should look at that and decide you wanted other towns, you could just let me know. Those happen to be the ones that were mentioned. So.
Well, they're the most similar, I think, to our ag and residential agricultural.
And I have Montague's as well.
You already have Montague's.
I have Montague's, so I can bring copies to the board.
All right. Yeah, that'd be helpful. All right, then we go to our annual budget. So we're not, so we already talked about your contract, Pat, did we? Or
right.
Are you?
So.
Right, this isn't a new one. We're halfway through the year.
We're halfway through on this one. As you can see from the bill, we're halfway through in time, but significantly further in dollars.
Right, but now if we end up billing
depending on
out, then I think that makes us back on track.
We'll have to figure that out because, there's a blank wall there for me. I mean, I send you the bill, I get paid. I don't know where that money comes from, so...
Right.
We still only are going to have that certain amount left in my contract, regardless of where you get the funds from to pay me.
Oh, okay. But, okay. If we wanted to, though, go back and redo the contract and add.
You could add.
So it sounds like the contract going forward, we have our basic charges with you, and then we have our peer review stuff.
We might have to think about something different for
change it to
the contract
to
come
cover
July
that.
If you want to do some different charging.
So right now, we've used about over half the year, we've used 80% of the
the time and money we had allotted.
Right.
Now, we don't have, now like, it might be that we get the money back, but the time is still the 80%, so.
But we don't have anything coming up next month.
We don't have another big project yet. It may be that this will be enough to get through. I mean, last year we didn't use anywhere near the 10,000. This year we've used a lot already, but maybe things will slow down. It's hard to.
But if that 5,000 from the applicant came back, that would put us.
Well, then we'd have to, then if we wanted more time, we'd have to go back and add to the contract.
We could do a contract amendment to add some additional time.
And this 5,000, John, where would it go when it comes in?
Revolving
into the revolving fund.
That's where all of our fees go. Yeah.
Okay.
So we would be able,
and then
to
we can take it out of there and pay, either the FERCOG or someone else.
So I guess what I'm saying is that if that money comes into us, then we should take it out of there to pay her. But if it doesn't come in there, do we take it out of our budget? And in the difference of the 3,200. You see what I'm saying?
I do. And actually this year, we were budgeted so much by the town. Now we're going to get into next. What are we going to ask for next year? And I think we could recommend that we ask for less next year because we can use more from the revolving fund, or we'll bill applicants appropriately. So maybe we can ask for less from the operating budget.
I was just thinking about something. Rather than think about it going into our fund and out of our fund, why don't we just think of it as we take her bill and we hand it to the applicant? It's a pass-through.
Well, if you can, and then we do an estimate, and then if it's off, you can just update it 2 months into the project.
If I'm hearing what Pat's saying, she has a contract with us, not with anybody else.
Correct.
Well, right, but, I'm just... on my jobs, if we have to hire police officers, we take the bill from the police department and we just hand it to the state.
See, I think if Pat
we pay
had given
it up front, but then
I think if Pat had given them an estimate for the 5,000, then they could pay her directly. But that didn't happen.
No, even then they would never pay me directly. It has to come through the town through the special account.
Oh, it does.
Oh, yeah, because we're hiring.
That's why we have the revolving account.
Still, I would still be working for the town.
Right.
It's just the applicant would pay for it, but I would still be working for you guys.
No, that's absolutely what we need to start thinking about when we're asking Pat to work on a project for an A&R or a site plan review. Some of her other work is like this fee schedule thing that we can't bill to anybody else, and that's what we need to ask for money, either from the town or from our revolving fund.
It also seems to me there's a distinction here, because if we don't spend $10,000, we don't save that money, it's gone. If it's in the revolving fund, it goes on from year to year. So there is a distinction, I think, between the revolving fund and our budget. So we've got to be careful and keep the monies that way. You see what I'm saying?
But if it doesn't come out of the money that's budget to us, if we don't use it, it just goes back to the town.
The budget money, but the revolving fund doesn't go back to the town.
I understand that. So what's wrong with having to go back to the town?
No, he's saying that's fine, I think.
No, I'm saying it's fine. That's why I'm saying the distinction between monies that come out of our budget and monies that come out of the revolving fund is pretty serious, because one of the things is carried forward,
right,
and one is not. So, and I don't have a problem. If we only spend 5 and we budgeted 10, give the town back the 5. That's not my point. It's just that we need to keep track of these things that should go through revolving fund, because that's a whole different story.
Well, there is a difference, because when it comes to budgeting, putting in for 10, getting 10, and then only using 5, that's just not fair to the town. I mean,
we haven't distinguished that in the past. We'd need to look at it. I believe I agree with you. If we don't need to bid, the revolving fund always goes to the town meeting at $25,000, and our budget's been $10,000. But the 25 is you either use it if you have to or you don't, and it's the money that's actually accrued there is what carries forward, not 25,000.
And I had asked for how much is in there. It's not 25,000. The maximum it can be is 25,000.
That's what I'm saying.
But I think it's
not a specific amount.
I think it's more than.
We have about 13 or 15,000,
something like
that.
About 12 or something. So I would suggest that for this next year that we ask for a little bit less.
knowing that we're going to bill directly a lot of the expenses if it's a site plan review or something, and knowing that we do have some money in our revolving fund.
For 2016, we asked for and received $7,500. Now, it looks like they just have an estimate of $8,700.
Right, and that's what he wants us to decide tonight.
Right.
I think what the reason it's that number is that John Baronis, I think if I remember correctly, said, let's reduce what we budget last year. I think that's
yeah,
where,
I ask,
I think
please?
That's how we did it. John,
we've been going
it.
Down the past,
we've
you
been
can
going
see the
down.
Past 3 years.
So, so.
Well, the 2015 was not, I did ask in 2015, and I was voted against by the board, but then the town came in and said, well, you're getting a haircut whether you like it or not. So that's what happened in 15. 16, we all agreed, yeah, let's set a trend.
Well, see, if we keep better track of Pat's here and assign our budget money and our revolving fund, then when we come to this point next year, we'll know how much we've spent, how much we need. And if we need to reduce it, we reduce it.
John, let me ask you this, because I just don't know. On the figure under 2016 where it says planning services,
right.
$6,450, and then the other one, operational expenses right. and training. I understand that, or a total of 75, but do we have an account of how much of that money we've used?
Basically, it's the bill we got.
Well, when he drew that up, he didn't have my bill yet. Well, so that's why I wanted to get you my bill.
Well, this is what we basically asked for. It was appropriated for, 2016.
So
the only money that we've expended as a board is through the FRCAR.
Right.
Pretty much, yes.
And they're, this is operational expenses. Sometimes they send me a bill and they say, hey, will you approve $62 for mailing or something? And I approve it, you know. So there's a few little funky things, but that's pretty minor. So it's primarily the FERCOG, yeah. We signed a contract with the FERCOG, which is interesting.
Correct.
For $10,000, even though.
Up to $10,000.
Up to $10,000.
And we've not always spent up to
And we had $6,450 in our budget, but we knew that we had money in the revolving fund if we needed it, is why we did that. And we felt comfortable doing it.
Well, I'm of the opinion that, into 2016, we trimmed the fat as much as we can. Going into 2017, I think we go even $7,500. That's my thoughts. And going to the revolving fund, if we need to make up any deficits.
$7,500 total.
Yes.
Because you see the guy, and I don't know who, you just split those numbers. Or
$7,500 total.
A little arbitrary, I guess.
And I think, with Kip's earlier comments, maybe we can pay a little closer attention to what Pat's services are being used for at times. I don't know if this was a.
I think this was unusual. I don't.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
This was a pretty big project.
And I think it got day one. I didn't think it was going to be that much because the way they came in, they had to prepare it, and we said we were going to have another engineer review it. But then things every month something happened, And so that's I think what happened.
It's going to be at the high end of the scale in terms of the amount of time and cost associated with a project review.
Did you have this here?
I was copied on an email. I don't think I have the full budget.
Had a
but,
copy. I'm just,
I'm just
curious how that all, Doug's not here to tell us, but 2016, it says $6,450 and $10,50 for a total of $7,500. And then
that was budgeted. That's what was budgeted.
So this isn't actual at all. This is just what was budgeted.
Right. The actual is what I'm telling you. It's
$8,195.
So we've overspent the budget then.
Yes.
Okay. I thought you said we were at 80% of the budget. That's why I was questioning.
Of the
we're
contract
80%
amount.
Of the $10,000 that we contracted with the FERCOG on.
Oh, okay. That's where.
But
I was
that included some of the revolving fund money.
I see. Okay.
So all this is the town. $7,500 is the town budgeted money. If we need more than that, we go to the revolving fund.
Okay.
So I would agree either keep it flat or even go down another $1,000 if we want, knowing that we have money in the revolving fund, knowing that we're going to try to send bills directly to applicants
Well, I also wondered if we're only $1,000, if that's the difference between what we would reduce it by, then let's keep it where it is and give them back the $1,000 at the end of the year. If it was $5,000, I'd say cut it back. But
well, there's always a chance we're going to get trimmed anyway. So if we knock $1,000 off now,
then they might knock another.
No, I'm just saying it's not like we're going to say at the end of the year how much we've got left to spend and go spend it. It's going to go back.
I know. I mean, part of it is perception. You know, when you're at the town meeting, people love to see a little $500 decrease. So it doesn't, you know, like you say, it doesn't matter.
It really doesn't matter.
We're not the biggest budget line item on our town budget. Far. So I don't think anybody's really ever going to.
It's going to matter.
No one's going to jump up and down about this one. So
we're not going to build a new building just for our planning board.
All right. So we just keep it as 2016?
Yep.
I think
good
so.
Good to me. What do you think, Max?
I propose that we. How do I? I haven't done this.
Make a motion.
I make a motion.
Okay, you're going to make a motion.
That we use 2016 funding levels for 2017.
Second?
I second the motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Oh, all these 600s tonight. This is such a unanimous consensus.
Son of a gun, what's going on here?
Then you know what he's going to ask us next, Paul.
What's that?
For a report.
Oh, yeah. I was hesitating to say those words, but we'll see what we can do.
We are bad at our annual report.
Okay, we're at a request for comment.
All right, we have some really important mail here. Apparently,
so we're requesting level funding, right?
Yes.
Every time I get up and leave, because I think you all are done with me, I jump back up here. But I think now you probably really are done with me.
Yeah,
I'm going to sit back.
I don't even know what's RFC from.
I would say that's a request for comment.
That's right.
Oh,
that's
you.
What it
Jesus,
says here.
You're brilliant. Okay.
Request for comments from the Deerfield zoning board regarding a request for a bed and breakfast and meditation center at 595B River Road.
Wasn't that brought before our meeting a couple meetings ago?
I don't think they were ready or something.
May have been some general discussion, but nothing official.
Thank you. I'm not finding it here.
River Road, so that's Ag Res, but there is some commercial over in that area also, so exactly where.
You've got an application that should designate what zone it's in.
We don't have an application. The zoning board does.
Send you a copy of something. Well,
right? 595B River Road. So, Roger, whereabouts is 595?
Oh, here it is.
No idea.
Yeah, because that's not your district.
John, do you have internet connection on your laptop?
If I knew the Wi-Fi password.
Because you can go to the zoning, the assessor's website,
right.
And there's a map there, and you can punch in the number, and it'll zoom in, and it'll tell you what zone it's in.
Yeah, it looks like I'm connected.
The ZBA hearing is scheduled for January 21st. The special permit to operate a B&B to operate a meditation center.
Does it have any names or anything, John?
Fleet Mall and Kate Crisp. Because I was wondering if it was a one up behind Atlas Farm there.
Well, that's what I was thinking.
There has been one there.
Right.
And I know it was for sale, so maybe it's the new owners. They have to get another.
Right. That's what I was, when they said B, because that was like they own both properties and they sold one to Gideon.
I forget the name of what they.
So it's not a change of use or anything. It's just a continuation.
Well, it's new owners, I guess they probably need a special permit. They usually don't ask us for comment, do they?
I think that's probably somewhere in the old Teddy Tuego.
Well, that's what we're talking about,
oh,
John.
It is, yeah.
So. I mean.
Doesn't sound like it's a big concern.
I was going to say, anywhere on River Road, does it even almost matter? Do we have any objections about B&Bs or meditation centers?
Well, just as long as they don't expect their neighbors to, you know, it's ag res.
It's all special permit, which they're going to the ZBA for, so.
If we don't oppose it, then they should also understand that they're, it doesn't really give them any new rights. Or, you know, you can call it a meditation center, but it might not be very conducive.
Well, I think at the very least, if somebody has a question, we could go to the zoning board meeting and find out what it is. But other than that, I don't see a problem.
Yeah.
Well, I guess when it comes to something like this, I think no comment might be
the right comment.
Instead of saying, we see no
because,
problem.
Because, I mean, I don't know if it's a great thing, but I don't know if it's a bad thing. Right. You know, there's a meditation center that's sort of broad, I think, what.
All right, I'm saying no comment.
There you go.
January 21st, if anybody wants to. Go to that. And the other mail is just. This is just other towns having similar type public special permit hearings, probably. And then apparently we haven't heard anything further about our other solar projects in Deerfield, so. Any other items not reasonably anticipated at the time we posted this agenda? Mm-hmm. Hearing none, do we have a motion to adjourn?
You want to set our next meeting date?
And the next meeting date, Monday, February 1st?
7 p.m., yeah.
First Monday of...
Okay.
So who's moving it?
Kip, was that a motion by you?
Oh, no, I was just asking when the next meeting was. Oh, but I make a motion that we adjourn.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
600.